glory to Him who was glorified, glory to Him who was glorified, glory to Him who was crowned, and glory to Him who you received for us all.
All Michael, we stand together radiant before the Lord, turning to good, together with all the heavenly hosts, and with them despite all our song inspired by God. Let's pray the Lord. Thank you.
received you here, so have mercy.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for all pious and Orthodox Christians.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for Archbishop Isaiah, of our brotherhood in Christ.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
For you are merciful God, who loves mankind, and you send them glory, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and ever, and to the ages of ages. pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Bishop Isaiah, the old presbytery, the acting in Christ, for the clergy and ladies, let us pray to the Lord. Thank you.
Nyrus, and Orion. On this day, we commemorate the deliverance of the holy great martyr George from the torture wheel, which in the land of Georgia is kept as the saint's principal feast. On this day, we commemorate the holy martyr Constantine, the magnanimous, prince of Georgia, who was perfected in martyrdom in the year 842. On this day, we commemorate the translation of the holy relics of our father among the saints, Gregory, bishop of Assos in Anatolia. On this day, we commemorate the holy new hyper martyr, Rodio, Archimandrite of the Spaso Hermitage in the Kharkov province, who was slain by the atheists in the year 1917. By the intercessions of thy saints, O God, have mercy on us and save us.
that I love you, Jesus, center of me, my sheep.
Truly, truly,
I say to you, when you were young, you girded yourself and went and walked where you would. When you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will gird and carry you where you should not wish to go.
This he said to show by what death he was to glorify God.
And after this he said to follow me.
Peter turned and saw following them the disciple of Jesus, not relating close to his breast of the sun, and said, Lord, is that is going to betray you? And Peter saw and he said to Jesus, Lord, what about this man? Jesus said to him, it is not going to be named until I come. What is that to you? Follow me. The same spread abroad among my brethren and his disciples not to die. But Jesus did not say to them that he was not to die. But if it is my will, they remain until I come. What is that to you? This is the disciple who is bearing witness to these things, whose written these things we know that his testimony is true. But there are also many other things which Jesus did, every one of them rewritten, and suppose that the word itself are not contained. The books that would be written.
Glory to you, Lord.
Nice. patriarchs of Alexandria, of Nicholas of Myras, Gernot, Bishop of Crete, and Ethiopes, Dionysius, Archbishop of Aegina, and Nectarius of Pentapolis, the wonder workers, of the holy glorious great martyrs, George the trophy bearer, Demetrius the murder flowing, Theodore the recruit, Theodore the general, and Minos the wonder worker, of the higher martyrs, Ignatius, Polycarp, Philopolis, Eleutherios, and Cosmos, of the holy glorious and great women martyrs, Thecla, Barbara, Anastasia, Catherine, Kidiaki, Patini, Marina, Paris, Eve, and Irene, of the holy glorious and victorious martyrs, of our righteous and God-bearing fathers who illuminated asceticism, of Saint Spiridon, patron saint of this holy temple, of the righteous, holy, and righteous ancestors of God, Joachim and Anna, of Erastus, Olympus, Rhodion, Sospater, Quotas, and Teratos, apostles of the 70s, of Orestes, the martyrs of Cappadocia, of the holy fathers Arsenius of Cappadocia, and our holy father Gregory, Bishop of Asa, whom we commemorated, of all your saints who beseech you, O holy most merciful Lord, hear us sinners who pray to you, and have mercy on us.
Lord, have mercy.
Thank you.
ourselves and ever Virgin Mary with all the saints. Let us commit ourselves to one another and our whole life to Christ our God.
Holy is our Lord, our God.
Holiness, understanding, God's child to me and shown to his life. So that it may be found worthy, this is also the spiritual, which I know reasons to you. And that this child may be known and under the holy law. We do have only begotten Son, who you are blessed, yet of your own, given by the Holy Spirit, now and ever to the ages of ages.
Amen.
Servant of God, Aquilina, is brought into the church in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In the middle of the church, I shall praise you. The servant of God, Aquilina, is brought into the church in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Now, Master, let your servant depart in peace, according to your promise. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light of revelation to the Gentiles, and glory to your people Israel. Glory to thee, O our God and our hope. Glory to thee.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. Amen. Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy, Lord have mercy. Holy Mass for us.
May Christ, our true God, who submitted himself, be held in the arms of the righteous Savior, for our salvation. Through the intercession of his most pure and defiled Holy Mother, through the power of the precious and life-giving cross, through the protection of the honorable blessed powers of the heavens, through the prayers of the honorable glorious prophet, foreigner, John the Baptist, of the holy glorious and all-praised apostles, of the holy glorious victorious martyrs, of our venerable God, great fathers, of the holy righteous, ancestor of God, Joachim and Anna, and of Saint Aquilina, the patron saint of this child. May our Lord God have mercy on us and save us, for he is good and merciful and loves humankind. Through the prayers of holy fathers, Lord Jesus Christ our God, have mercy upon us and save us. Congratulations on the birth of Aquilina Faith. She was born on the feast day of St. Aquilina, and so takes Aquilina as a namesake. She's absolutely precious, out like a light. I would like to be able to celebrate the liturgy just holding her. But Alexandria and Victor, we look forward to the day of her rebirth by water and spirit. And once again, we wish God's blessings upon you and many years to your beautiful daughter, Aquilina. Close out our morning prayer. We hope that you've taken one of the black hymnals up. If so, on page 1 in our black hymnals, you can join our choir in the singing of the Great Doxology.
We give thanks.
The Theotokos and ever Virgin Mary with all the
Let us commit ourselves and one another and our whole lives to the Christ our God.
Thank you. justified by faith in Christ, and not by works of the law, because by works of the law shall no one be justified. But if, in our endeavor to be justified in Christ, we ourselves were found to be sinners, is Christ then an agent of sin? Certainly not. But if I build up again those things which I tore down, then I prove myself a transgressor. For I, through the law, died to the law, that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me.
Said the one who showed mercy on him, and Jesus said to him, us, those of us who are joining us online. Months ago, we began as a community to consider how we might honor the veterans and first responders in our own community and in our surrounding community. And for this, I'm especially thankful to Jake Ruggles, who is almost on his own, established last year in this year's program. And I'm also thankful to Jason Mantis and Timothy Ullman, who have also added to today's events. Now, the honor of our veterans and first responders happens to fall on the Sunday in which we read and commemorate the story of the Good Samaritan. And I have to say that this is one of those godly coincidences. It kind of boggles the mind. And even in my own preparation, it wasn't until the latter part of the week that I started to connect the dots. To connect the fact that we're going to honor veterans and first responders on a Sunday in which we also read the story of the Good Samaritan. Now, for those of us who are familiar with the story that comes to us from Luke chapter 10, we know that the story of the Good Samaritan is Jesus' answer to a question posed by a young lawyer. The reading begins with the man asking Jesus about how he might get into heaven. And in response to that question, Jesus asks him to answer the question for himself by looking at what the Bible teaches. The lawyer replies that the Bible teaches that I'm supposed to love God and my neighbor. Satisfied, Jesus says to the young man, "Yep, you got it right. Do this and you will live." But as the story illustrates, the lawyer wasn't finished, and I guess they never are. Perhaps he didn't really understand what loving God and neighbor meant. Because he goes on to ask Jesus one more question. And who is my neighbor? He's kind of speaking it to Jesus. And the story of the Good Samaritan is Jesus' answer. Now, for those of us who are familiar with it, we know that the outline of the story is simple. There's a man, and he goes on a journey. And on that journey, he's robbed, he's beaten, and then left to die in a ditch. Now, as he lay there in need of help, two men pass by and both ignore him. Finally, a third man, a Samaritan. He also comes upon the man, and unlike the first two, he stops. And out of compassion, the story tells us, he renders assistance. Now, you have to question yourself when you read the story as to why the first two ignored the man. And why did the third man stop? And the answer is the same. Love. For the first two, love was the missing ingredient. While for the Samaritan, it was the opposite. Now, when you think about this story, it's all rather ironic, because the lawyer's knowledge of Scripture had indeed led him to quote the two great commandments found in God's law. To love God, to love God with all one's heart, soul, and mind. And the second, to love one's neighbor, to love one's neighbor as one's self. And yet, the young man's knowledge is totally incomplete. Now, it's interesting to note that in Scripture, the word knowledge in Greek does not simply mean to know something in your head. Rather, it means to experience something in your heart. We know this, even if we don't know Greek, because although the young lawyer could quote the commandments, he did not live them. As we said, in his mind, love is simply a concept. It's an abstract. But it is not something that would cause him to do something for someone else. Now, of course, our understanding of this story is that it is a type of parable, an illustrative story that provides us with a description of a greater truth. Specifically, that love is not an inner emotion alone, but rather love is something that results in serving others. Now, if you're familiar with the great and ancient tradition of depicting scripture in pictures, which we call icons, then you know that in the icon painted of the Good Samaritan is shown as Christ himself, leaning over the beaten man, looking into his face. And when we look at this icon of the story, it makes sense. Especially when we consider the broader reason for why Christ did anything on earth. We know that Christ was always motivated by just one thing, love. This is why one of the greatest names that we give to Christ is philanthrope, the lover of humankind. When we lose sight of this, we lose sight of everything. And so it is with this in mind that we return to the story and we notice who responded first. The one who loved. Now, just like those that we honor today, veterans, firemen, policemen, EMTs, we know that all of them, women and men who serve, they are the first to respond. They are the Good Samaritans. And in our own lives, their example is like Christ. And so it's instructive. We see in them an answer to what it means to be a true human being. You know, in the language of the church, we can say that being truly human is another way of saying heaven. And being truly human means responding first, not walking by, to those in need. It means that love for us should not be a concept, is not an emotion or even an inner conviction, but it is an act of service. And I find all of this challenging, as I'm sure you do as well. How is it that I respond to the cases of need? Am I first? And so today we say to our veterans and first responders, thank you. Thank you for your service, and thank you for caring and loving all those that you encounter that are in need. Thank you, because we see in you Christ at work. And thank you, because of your example, we are convicted and hopefully inspired to do the same. Amen. We continue to invite you to join us in prayer. And in your black service books, if you turn to page 27, you can continue with our choir.
Wisdom enough and practice, but always guided by your power, we make it glory to you, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit now and ever, and to the ages.
Thank you.
ask of the Lord.
Thank you.
which is broken for you to the remission of sins. Likewise, do the cup after the supper, saying, drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins.
Thank you.
shall be restored.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, I ask for your forgiveness.
facing a sinful man. Please forgive me.
Thank you.
serving of that weight. I see the freshness of all of the body, but the Lord God, the Savior Jesus Christ, and the remission of sins of the life everlasting. Amen. And may each of God go and receive the freshness of all.
Thank you. Precious.
us worthily give thanks unto the Lord.
Please come forward. In your service books, if you will look at the back, you'll notice there's a tab titled Special Services. If you'd please tap to that page, and you'll notice that there's a service entitled Archiplesia. If you just go past that, you'll find a service entitled the Memorial Service. What we're going to do is first offer a prayer for the service members of our community who have passed from this life in service to their country and to their fellow brothers and sisters. And then we're going to invite retired Colonel Timothy Ullman of the Air Force to come forward, who served for decades as a chaplain, to come forward and read a prayer for our veterans and first responders.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Christ our God, the God of spirits and of all flesh, you yourself trampled down death and abolished the power of the devil, and you granted life to your world. We pray to you that you would grant rest to the soul of your departed servants, John, Jess, Eugene Todd, Albert Pitts, Ron Tassi, Anthony Lucia, John Lucia, Charles Lucia, Frank Lucia, Tony Lucia, Eugene Lucia, Spiro Fotopoulos, Edgar Newcomb, Angelo Sothopoulos, Donald Kemper, Richard Kemper, Otter Pretzner, Daniel Newcomb, C.S. Aldrich, Chancey Newcomb, Polly Newcomb, Jerry Barr, Leon Jones, Kenneth Fox, Maurice O'Dell. For Pete, Emmanuel, Emmanuel Budden, Robert, Thomas, Constantina, Andrew Nelson, Nicholas Lawrence, D. Sims, and Don Sims, who have served, O Lord, we ask that you would grant to each of them rest in a place of light.
Amen.
In a place of repose.
Amen.
In a place of refreshment.
Amen.
Where there no longer is pain or sorrow and suffering. As a good and loving God, forgive every sin they have committed in thought, word, or deed, for there is no one who lives and is sinless. You alone are without sin. Your righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and your word is true. For you are the resurrection, the life, and the repose of your departed servants, O Christ our God. And to you we send up glory with your eternal Father, your holy, good, and life-giving Spirit, now and ever, and to the ages of ages. At this time, as I mentioned, we invite forward retired Colonel Timothy Ullman, the chaplain of our U.S. Air Force, who served, as I said, for many years, who will offer a prayer of blessing upon our first responders and veterans here gathered. Chaplain Timothy.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus Christ, and all Holy Spirit, in every age you call certain men and women to defend, protect, and safeguard the human family from oppression, tyranny, calamity, and evil. You raised up David to confront and defeat Goliath. You raised up Judas Maccabeus to seize victory over the arrogant pagans who would not call on your holy name. And you raised up St. George, who loved you more than life itself. Blessed Lord, you continue to raise up such men and women in our own time and nation. Since the founding of this country conceived in liberty, countless men and women have stepped forward to defend, protect, and safeguard the people of our nation and communities from aggressors, to liberate those held captive, to comfort the suffering, and to promote freedom and justice. Today, we honor veterans, police officers, firefighters, and all first responders, those who rest in revered glory, those who still suffer from the wounds of war and violent engagements, those who enjoy the blessings of living in the land of the free and the home of the brave, as well as our servicemen and women, police officers, firefighters, and first responders who are currently, this day, this very hour, serving and facing dangers. Lord Jesus Christ, you tell us, greater love has no man than he lay down his life for another. These revered men and women are our nation's and community's sheepdogs, who willingly offer their lives to guard and protect your flock. Gracious Lord, thank you for the selfless sacrifice, the sacrificial love and dedication of these servicemen, veterans, police officers, firefighters, and first responders. We also thank you for the sacrifices of their families who support them and endure hardships many cannot begin to understand. Help us to remember these warriors and their families in our prayers. Move us to care for them, to love them, and to express our gratitudes to them in tangible ways. And may the souls of our departed veterans, police officers, firefighters, and first responders find eternal rest and peace in your kingdom. And may we comfort their families with your unfailing love. Great physician of our souls, we humbly ask you to heal our wounded veterans, police officers, firefighters, and first responders through the grace of your all-holy Spirit, and grant your peace that surpasses all understanding to comfort those who continue to experience emotional, physical, and psychological trauma. We also pray for healing and peace to all people who live in the regions in which our veterans have fought, and in all communities in which our police officers, firefighters, and first responders encounter dangers. God of peace and love, we ask for an end to wars and violence, and that you would bring the dawn of a new era of peace. Give us the creative vision to see a world which, grown weary with fighting and violence, moves to value the life of every human being and moves beyond war and hatred. Help us not to exclude other nations and peoples of the world, but to include them in a loving and harmonious global family. For you, O Lord, are the lover of mankind. Turn the hearts and minds of our leaders and those who are enemies to the works of justice and peace, of love and harmony for all people. Hear our prayer, O Prince of Peace, and may the peace you left us, the peace you gave us, be the peace that sustains us and the peace that saved us. For you, to you belong all glory, honor, and worship. To the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto the ages of ages.
Amen. We thank once again our veterans and first responders for their presence this day. We also thank those who pass from this life for their service, and we ask and pray that God grant them eternal rest. For our guests today, we have a gift, a prayer card of the Archangel Michael, the protector of the heavenly hosts and the battler of evil, to give to them, as well as a bracelet, and the leftovers we'll give to you as well. We also invite you after the dismissal to join us for a luncheon. All of you, please join us. We'd like to serve you a meal, and then I think the kiddos would also like to clamber around the fire trucks and the ambulances and all the rest. Let's offer them our heartfelt appreciation through a round of applause. Reconstruction of those areas damaged will begin. If you come during the week, there will only be one approved entrance to the church, just for your safety. It will be the Breezeway West door, so please be aware of that. In addition, this week, we do have tomorrow night our moms group for all moms. Doesn't matter how old your kiddos are. Leave them at home and come here for an evening of conversation about our upcoming Advent season. We're also going to discuss one of the saints of the church. That's tomorrow evening at 7 p.m. Our men's group meets the following day, 6 p.m., and on Wednesday, we do have liturgy for St. John Chrysostom, the earliest exegete of Scripture in a, if you will, entirety. He looked at all the Scriptures and wrote on them one of the great saints of the church, St. John the Golden Mouth, will celebrate a liturgy this Wednesday at 9:30 in his memory. Additionally, when you come forward, not only do we have these bracelets to celebrate the service of our veterans and first responders, and we'll hand those out. We do have a luncheon next door that you hopefully will join us for. But I'm also going to be handing out these bookmarks. If you didn't yet receive one, they've got the readings for our church school and for our Sunday services. Last but not least, we would like to welcome our beloved guest. I don't know that I have everyone's name, but I've got George Agris, I don't know if I pronounced that correctly, Spencer Cooney, Brenda and Hannah Cohn, and Stephen Suloff and friends. We also welcome a group visiting us. Patricia, I know that they're here in the middle, but I don't know what group this is. Where's Stephen?
Lifebridge.
In Longmont. So this morning we welcome a group from Lifebridge Church in Longmont on Highway 66, right? The highway who's here with us this morning to worship with us. We welcome you. Hopefully you can join us for fellowship afterwards. I think I announced everything. I hope. Once again, thank you, veterans and first responders. On your way out, if you have not yet picked up one of our Thanksgiving bags to serve one of the families in need, or dropped off your shoes, used shoes in the breezeway, please do so. There is no Bible study this Tuesday, for those asking. Thank you. Jacob? Sorry. One last announcement. Okay, so the SWAT car with the grenade launchers will only be outside for another 45 minutes if you'd like to see it. God's blessings. Thank you, Jacob. Please come forward to receive your adieu. It does. It has grenade launchers. morning, sweetheart. I'll make it. How can I give you? Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah. asked for, he's regularly asked these things, so it's all like before you leave for your Sundays.
So, in the back halves of the church, of course, you can see Christ. And something distinct is that he only has a half of a body in that icon. So you only see the top half of his body, because who is the body of Christ? We are, the church is. So he's always shown in this fashion. Here we have him in the top of the apse. This icon is usually in a dome. So he'll be in the top of the dome. We don't have a dome here. So we put him at the top of the apse, and he's also the first thing that you see when you come into the church. In his left hand, he has the gospel. In the right hand, he's blessing. And if you see the way he's blessing, he's holding his hand up like this. So we do everything very purposeful. All the iconography is very purposeful. And so in his hand, you can see I-C-S-C, which is the initials of Jesus Christ. So he's blessing with his name. And even when a priest comes out and blesses, he doesn't bless by his authority, but he comes out and blesses in the name of Christ. And then below this icon of Christ is the icon of Mary. This is a very common one that's put in the rear of the church. It's called More Spacious Than the Heavens. And we look toward Mary, not because of who she is, but because of who she always points to. So she's always pointing toward Christ. And this icon is called More Spacious Than the Heavens, because who did she contain? Christ in the womb. And who is the creator of the whole universe and the sustainer of the whole universe? Christ. So somehow, mystically, she was able to contain the uncontainable. And so we call her More Spacious Than the Heavens. And she has a lot of titles, but they're all in relation to Christ. So one is Directress, because she points toward Christ.